From being the star singer at her church and being one of our first queer icons to becoming the biggest pop icon in African music, on our final episode this season, we took a look at the life of the legend named Brenda Fassie in the eyes of the media. Born on the 3rd of November 1964, Brenda Nobuzola Fassie was the youngest in a musical family of nine. Her dad, Matthews Mangaliso Fassie, who died when Brenda was two, worked at Barclays Bank. He was a disciplinarian, a sports fan, and a very talented singer. Her mother was a lead pianist in a five-piece ensemble, and she assembled a successful group called the Tiny Tots, where Brenda sang lead at just 4 years of age. Named after country singer Brenda Lee, she performed at church events, accompanied by her mother on the piano. And already by the age of five, she had tourists paying to hear her sing. At 11 years of age, she was singing with Cosmos, a band in which her brother Keith played the piano. As soon as she became a teenager, Brenda ran away from home and hitchhiked away to Johannesburg to find better opportunities before Gibson Gente made his way to Langa to ask her mother for permission to take Brenda under his wing. And when she refused, the rebellious Brenda made her way to his home in Soweto against her mother's orders.
And I walked it to Soweto to find Gibson Gente's place. After Gibson Gente left Cape Town and after my mother refused for me to go. So the next thing, she sent police behind to look for me. They couldn't find me.
He proceeded to cast her onto his musical shows such as Hungry Spoons. She went back to Langa, but Sabata Koloi Lebona brought her back to Gauteng in 1979 after ensuring her mother that she would continue her education. It did not take long for her to find audiences in her newly adopted home in White City, Soweto. She enjoyed entertaining and singing for people, but soon got in with the wrong crowd. Marijuana, cigarettes, and alcohol proving too much for Lebona's wife Ethel. Brenda soon bailed out of school and met Toa Ndlozi of the musical trio Joy. When she had caught wind of auditions for a substitute singer, as one of the members of the trio, Annalene, had gone on maternity leave, Joy's management was wooed by Brenda. She auditioned for the spot and was chosen to fill in for her. A moment that was most crucial to the star that is Brenda, as Afropop was coming of age in the country. In an interview with journalist Bongani Madondo, Fassie stated, "At that moment, I was so scared, but I knew. I knew my moment had arrived."
There are better days before us, and the burning bridge behind us, fire smoking. The sky is blurring. There is a woman waiting, weeping, and the young man nearly beaten all for love. Paradise is almost closing down.
Brenda decided to fly her wings. She left school and chased after the bright future that was ahead of her. After her tenure with Joy came to an end, Brenda made an appearance on the Blondie and Papa Roadshow. Having been brought in by one of the bandmates, Dumisani Ngubeni, the group decided to take Brenda under their wing to form the group Brenda and the Big Dudes, with Brenda Fassie on the vocals, Dumisani Ngubeni and Desmond Molotana on keyboards, David Mabaso on bass, and Rufus Glass on the guitar. In 1983, they released their debut single, Weekend Special, a song about a boyfriend who would only see her on weekends. Released at a time Madonna's holiday was stirring up a storm, the band promoted the song in township shebeens to catch the attention of DJs. The song soon got picked up and became a disco hit. Weekend Special topped the South African charts before Brenda Fassie was 20 years old. British and American remixes were released in 1986 and eventually took the group on tour to the United States, Brazil, Europe, and Australia. With the song reaching number one on the top radio stations in the country, they performed the song in front of 100,000 people who paid 4 rand each to watch them perform at Ellis Park Stadium on a promotional tour with EMI.
Friday night.
By spring of 1983, Weekend Special had achieved multi-platinum status sales in excess of 200,000 copies and was the fastest-selling single of that year. It peaked at number 72 on the Billboard Hot Black Singles chart and remained there for 8 weeks. It also topped the charts in South America, Europe, and Australia. In the United Kingdom, it was remixed by Ian Levine. The song was popular in both underground radios and clubs in the United Kingdom, United States, and South Africa. Brenda's tour and rise to stardom resulted in Time magazine dubbing her as the Madonna of the townships. The B-side, Life is Going On, a tune with influence of blues, was released and instantly became a timeless ballad, showing Brenda's vocal power in the style of Whitney Houston. As a full album, Weekend Special continues to sell well as a collector's item and enjoys enduring popularity among a new generation of music lovers. Brenda and the Big Dudes became the most famous exponents of South African disco, a merger of the United States disco beat with the late 1970s South African soul. Brenda and the Big Dudes produced 6 records together. Cool Spot EP released in 1984, which featured the hit It's Nice to Be with People. It's nice to be with people. Let's Stick Together and Someone to Love in the same year. Higher and Higher, released in 1985, featured the hit title track Higher. And Promises. Touch Somebody was released in the same year as their final EP, No No, Senor. These releases marked Fassie at the helm of the burgeoning pop renaissance in South Africa. Whilst working with the band, Brenda found her footing as a solo artist. She branched out and collaborated with Ronnie Joyce for their collaborative effort It All Adds Up, Miriam Makeba on her album Sangoma, and Harry Belafonte's apartheid album Paradise in Gazankulu. This collaboration resulted in the American singer inviting Brenda to join him on stage at Sally Mugabe's 1988 UNICEF Festival in Harare. It was also during these years where Brenda fell in love with one of the bandmates, Demise, and both would start a relationship. And within that relationship, their son, Wongani, was born. And even though Brenda's relationship with Demise was short-lived, Brenda was absolutely thrilled to be a mother and gushed so lovingly about her newfound love.
He is a singer, this guy. Do you want to please, can you sing for me? Please, born.
After garnering 4 platinum albums with the group, Brenda split from the Big Dudes around the same time her relationship with Demise fell apart. And in June 1987, she launched her solo career and released her self-titled debut album through CCP Records. With hits such as High Class and Izola Bad, this album showed the star quality of Brenda without the Big Dudes. (Music) the same year, her sophomore album, Ach Shame Lavi, produced by Chico Twala, followed. With the video of its hit single showcasing Brenda's playful side, Ach Shame Lavi endeared her to children all over the continent. A time before social media and TikTok became a thing, Brenda used a music video to create a dance routine with children of all ages. Followed by Umuntu Umuntu Ngabantu in 1988. And in 1989, the duo of Brenda and Chico released Too Late for Mama. Departing from the disco feel of her early tracks, the album was much truer to township music in Mbaqanga, but with added drum machines and slick production. This Mbaqanga pop hybrid, known as bubblegum, was a style Chico was famed for, and one that Fassie's impressive range and childlike intonations lent themselves to. Good Black Woman followed as the next single from the album, drawing inspiration from Uma Mwini Mandela. Fassie sang of the plight of Black people and particular hardships affecting women and mothers at the time. Black President followed in 1990, her most political offering. The album consisted of Shoot Them Before They Grow, with her most controversial lyrics. The most popular political song of them all was Black President, named after the trauma suffered by the resistance movement in South Africa in the early 60s as a result of the Sharpeville massacre and the arrest and banishment of Nelson Mandela and other Rivonia trialists. The record stormed in the Black townships and was immediately banned by the de Klerk government.
Because everything started to change in South Africa, we were reading papers that he's coming, he's coming, he's coming. I thought, let me dedicate this to me, let me see.
Fassie peaked towards the disintegration of the apartheid system, with many artists attempting to find their feet in the unstable political climate of daily riots, protests, boycotts, and action against apartheid repression. Her iconic music partnership with Chico Twala positioned her as the most influential and apt voice to reflect the plight of Black people. With money raking in from her hot-selling records, Brenda had the money, the fame, and the unstoppable stardom. She seemed to have everything, but she still just didn't feel enough. Brenda longed for love, and love came along, this time with a man by the name of Nhlanhla Mbambo. Soon after, it was reported that the couple eloped and wed in a secret civil ceremony, and the rumors turned out to be true. The couple chose to have a wedding anyway after Nhlanhla Mbambo had paid the Fassie family 13,000 rand for lobola. The 1989 wedding would cost 300,000 rand and consisted of three lavish receptions. The first reception was an exclusive ceremony with a few close friends and family at the Sand & Sun Hotel in Johannesburg. The second reception in Cape Town was attended by more than 1,000 people and had been dubbed the wedding of the century. Waving her 7,000 rand ring, it took 30 minutes to walk from the Cadillac to the altar as photographers crowded to capture her in her 12,000 rand silk brocade gown decorated in dozens of hand-beaded pearls with a 7-meter organza train by the Boys of Rosebank. The third ceremony was in Durban, with Fassie and Mbambo arriving by helicopter in front of 30,000 people in the KwaMashu Stadium. She celebrated the wedding with the track Don't Follow Me, I'm Married. With her rise in fame and fortune, Fassie's love life became the center of public attention and scrutiny. To some extent, she played into the hands of the media while scornful about her dislike for its presence in her life and constant fabrication. Her love for attention, adoration, and constant praise meant that she developed a complicated relationship with public life. Its unforgiving presence continued into the 90s, a decade that marked the beginning of her demise and struggle with drugs and alcohol addiction. After Fassie's accusations of abuse, the couple divorced in 1991. In 1993, Fassie lost her mother. The aftermath of events swallowed Fassie with a wave of sadness and depression. It was the start of Fassie's public descent into drug addiction as she checked in and out of rehab facilities, sued promoters, and began to accrue serious debts. Brenda was struggling to live under the strain of the spotlight. The bad press and negative spotlight motivated her to go back into the studio to record I Am Not a Bad Girl in 1991. Even though she did not meet society's standard of being a quote-unquote good girl, Fassie maintained that she was not a bad girl. When a group of about 200 armed men from Kwamadala Hostel invaded Boibatong on the 18th of June 1992, a massacre occurred where at least 45 residents of Boibatong were murdered. A hopeful country in despair, Fassie, amidst her spiral in the world of drugs, decided to include a tribute to the people of Boibatong on the song Boibatong featuring Tepotola in her Yo Baby album released that same year. In 1994, she struggled to record her album Abantu Bayakhuluma due to her cocaine addiction. When asked about how the recording with Papa Wemba went, she stated, "I can't remember a thing. I was so high." Throughout her solo career, Fassie stirred controversy with quote-unquote outrageous behavior and a turbulent private life. She openly admitted to being a drug addict, and her antics, both on and off the stage, made her a regular target for tabloid fodder in the Sunday papers. She was brave enough to openly come out as bisexual, which was taboo amongst Black South Africans. Her image became a turnoff for many of her fans, but she stood by it with her partner, Bobby Sihlahla, whom she fell in love with during her troubling years of addiction. And in 1995, she got a wake-up call and checked into her rehabilitation center when she woke up in her Johannesburg hotel room next to the body of Bobby, who had accidentally overdosed. But there were reports that she only stayed a day in rehab and decided to quit, but she was adamant that she had still been going to the facility. Bobby's death resulted in Brenda becoming bolder and confident in her sexuality, wearing more revealing outfits on stage, to the distaste of some of her fans who were not in support of her bisexual liberation. Bobby's death made Brenda reflect on her own drug binges, which were slowly taking over her life. Officials and so-called friends who proclaimed their love for the pop star judged her for her life choices. At the press conference that the Gauteng premier at the time, Tokyo Sekgwale, held for Brenda at her home after Bobby's death, he stated that Brenda was a diamond withering away. In the spirit of Masakane, we must build up what has been destroyed. In which Brenda doubted his sincerity since she was already trying to rehabilitate herself and replied ungratefully, "I'm doing it for myself." Industry peers whom she saw as friends came at her for what they deemed as uncanny ways.
And what people think my weaknesses are what they don't expect me to do. And they think, oh, she's rude or whatever. She's not expected to do this. No way. I'm not going to start justifying my character. My character is my character. And the way I am is the way I am, so take me the way I am. You know, if I want to do anything, I want to do anytime, anywhere with anybody, that's nobody's business. I mean, I do anything I want to do. Not because I'm Brenda Fassie, I can't fight if somebody says foot sex to me. Or maybe somebody swears at me more, you know? And then I don't react because, ooh, what are people gonna say if I fight? Forget it. Tata, no. Just now, put Brenda Fassie aside and then check you out.
As if grieving for her friend's death wasn't enough, Fassie was in the receiving end of a diss track from the late rapper Sinyaka, dissing her for allegedly turning him down on Majent. With Brenda responding to the diss with her own Amajent titled song that same year.
Me now you don't know.
The song became the biggest diss record to ever come out of South Africa. Senyaka would continue to diss Fassie and would shame her for her usage of drugs. When she was asked about the exchange between her and Senyaka, Brenda said, "Senyaka did drugs with me, so what the F is he on about?" During these hard years, tabloids feasted on the rise and fall of Brenda Fassie. Having made millions for close to two decades at the time, it was reported that she was overly generous with her monies and losing it rather carelessly. With her drug habits and generosity, Brenda became a catalyst in her being taken advantage of, resulting in frequent changes of personal managers. By now, Brenda should have been rich. Instead, she was staying just off Hillbrow in a small flat and was once even arrested for non-payment of debts. Those experiences had colored Brenda's perception of success, stating, "I'd rather have happiness than money. People ask for money sometimes when I don't have it. I make other people's problems my problem because they want me to, they ask me to. So sometimes I just wish I didn't have the little money that I do." Money that should have been invested got spent. Her expensive former lifestyle and former lovers were not the only culprits. According to those close to her, several managers had looked after their own interest instead of hers. "They filled their bellies on me," she said in an interview. When asked what caused the slump, she stated, "Money. I hate money. I give it all away. I spend it. That's why I'm not a rich girl." Her addiction and troubles hadn't stopped her first addiction, making music. Throughout her darkest period, Brenda continued to find an escape in recording music. The queen of Afropop continued to show her dominance in the lane she had carved, releasing Yo Baby featuring the hit Isiphetho Lendaba. As well as the gospel influenced Soon and Very Soon with the Children of God in 1994. Abantu Bayakhuluma, which earned her the Best Female Artist Award at the first Summers. Umuntu Uyashintsha with the Arthur Mafokate assisted Ngeke Umkhonfeme. Now Is the Time in 1996 and Paparazzi in 1997. The albums had a few hits, but the public's perception of her had taken a dip. Her private affairs and outspoken use of drugs had caused more of a stir than her actual albums. Fassie emerged from the ashes of intoxication, barely herself, but enough spark for longtime collaborator Twala to produce her 14th studio album, Memeza. The album was set up to save Brenda's career after the death of her lover. Memeza included the song Vulindlela, which became a hit throughout Africa and signaled the end of the decade and ushering a new one. The song spoke about the joy and pride of finally seeing a son get married and bring dignity to the family name. The song earned Fassie the 1999 Continental Kora Award for Best Female Artist, and who could forget her performance that evening when performing the song just for Umandela. The album earned Fassie two Summer Awards, Best Female Artist and Best Selling Release of the Year in 1999. Vulindlela was crowned Song of the Decade at the 2010 South African Music Awards. Fassie scooped the Summer's Best Selling Release Award for the next 3 years running with the Chico Twala produced albums Noma Kanjani in 1999, Amadlozi in 2000, Mina Nawe in 2001. Her greatest hits that same year, followed by Miegeleni in 2002 and Mali in 2004. Noma Kanjani and Memeza sold 500,000 copies. No other artist had ever come close to this record, not even the top-selling gospel star Rebecca Malope, whose album sales at the time are thought to be closer to the 250,000 mark. This resulted in Brenda scooping the best-selling album of the decade award at the South African Music Awards in 2004. All the love, hype, and accolades were back. Brenda was raking in the money, making millions, and she deserved every single penny. But unfortunately, even in the eyes of her fans, where it would seem she was in a better place, the reality was that she was not. She still splurged money like it was going out of fashion. And as much money as she was making, she was losing more. Her partner at the time, Gloria, stated that Brenda spent around 3,000 rand per day on her substance habit. Many friends and industry peers had tried their best to intervene and help, but the drug dealers got the best of her. According to Twala, throughout the years, Fassie checked in at rehabilitation centers 30 times at a cost of about 300,000. More money went down the drain when she wrote off 6 cars, including a Mitsubishi Pajero with 300,000 rand and a 280,000 rand BMW convertible. The Pajero, which is believed to have been taken by drug lords, disappeared without a trace. Twala told the Star that Fassie had been extravagant and always splashed out thousands of rands on friends, hangers-on, and drug lords. Brenda was her own person. She was wasting money like it was going out of fashion. In fact, the people to blame are the drug lords who always followed her around. Twala remembered one incident last year when he had to give Fassie 20,000 rand at about 3 a.m. in the morning. She came to my house and spoke through my intercom with a loud speaker. She had threatened to make a noise and disturb my neighbors if I didn't give her money. She told me she was driving to Lesotho with some friends. Brenda was living a fast life, staying in hotels and spending money on drugs, alcohol, and friends. The drug lords made a killing with Brenda. They are the ones to be blamed for the millions she spent recklessly. Twala believed Fassie could have made well over 30 million rands in her 21-year recording career. The Star reported that Brenda Fassie blew more than 10 million rands in the past 9 years. This amount was paid to her between July 1995 and February 2004. Brenda had been longing to pick up the pieces of her life as hard as it was to give up her drug habit. In the hours before her admission to hospital, she woke up that Sunday morning, put on a brave face, and decided to go to church. She told the congregation that she was tired of living like this, exhausted by drug binges and the tempest that her talent provoked. Her tantrums became expressions of her frustration at the world's inability to understand her properly. She needed love. The bad girl Brenda was just a facade, derailing the sweet, loving, and generous Brenda. The one who now, that spiritual morning, badly needed a break. Just over 12 hours later, Brenda stomped on the floor for her brother's attention as she was struggling to breathe. Talking to the Star, her brother stated, "She screamed my name, she couldn't breathe, and I took her outside for some fresh air." Reports were that her collapse were caused by drugs, but family members said that it stemmed from an asthma attack that led to heart failure and eventually brain damage. After the release of the post-mortem report and urine samples taken at the hospital testing positive, the report seemingly confirmed the former claim. She fell into a coma and stopped breathing. Her heart stopped beating and she had brain damage due to lack of oxygen. She had been on life support since then at Sunninghill Hospital, and on the 9th of May, Brenda succumbed to her condition.
Fellow South Africans, it is with a heavy heart and a deep sense of regret and sadness that the family of pop diva Brenda Fassie wish to advise that Brenda Fassie has passed away peacefully in her sleep.
Her memorial was held at the FNB Stadium and funeral at Langa Stadium with the attendance and tributes by former presidents Thabo Mbeki, Nelson Mandela, and various pop icons. She was 39 years old.
I want to say thank you for coming through for my mom. I dearly appreciate you, Mama. I just wanted to say hi to the president and go for coming here. Ngosta.
Brenda loved those close to her dearly. becoming a safe haven for little girls who just wanted to be heard, Brenda was often known to love and entertain children on the streets. She loved her industry peers, whom she thought and felt loved her just as genuinely as well. She loved hard, so hard, that she would tear up when it wasn't reciprocated in one way or the other. I often think about the heartbreaking story where Brenda mobilized around 200 supporters of Umzwakhe Mbuli when he was on trial in 1997. Brenda stood outside the magistrate's court under the blazing sun with a poster in hand demanding Mzwakhe to be freed, claiming that he was innocent. She was among the first people to visit him in Luoko prison. And then the day came when he was set free, only for Brenda to be seen weeping in the parking lot, having been refused entry into the prison, when Umam Winnie Mandela and others went in to meet Mbuli and prepare him for release. Yes, Brenda may have been complicated and emotionally unpredictable, but in my eyes, she was a woman with so much love to give and desperately needing it reciprocated. She felt lonely, and yes, substances were an escape from facing her troubles. What she struggled with was loving herself and that being enough. It wasn't her fault though. She grew up black and a woman in a country that abhorred black people and women. Having been a victim of domestic abuse by the man she chose to marry, to waking up from a high next to her lover who had overdosed, Brenda dealt with constant pain. When journalist Teresa Owen asked, "Are you happy, Brenda?" her characteristic charm visibly disappeared and replaced by despair. She responded, "No. No, I'm not happy. I'm not happy because I am so alone." I chose Brenda to celebrate for the final episode this season because just like Michael Jackson, we really will never ever have another Brenda Fassie. She paved the way for female artists to be expressive in any way they deem fit for their own image, in clothing, in music, speaking their minds on interviews. The artist who wore her flaws proudly for everyone to see and yet shown immense embrace and love by former presidents of the country. An artist who ran the show greater than any artist in the country ever could. No one could tell Brenda Fassie anything. Her music sold more than the biggest gospel artists in the country. The likes of Ulundi and Rebecca Malope would have only dreamt of selling half as much as she did. A super arranger, right up there with the greats. Listen, Brenda was making millions in her sleep solely by selling music. South African artists today are doing that with the help of performances, but Brenda became a millionaire through the selling of CDs and cassettes. Brenda toured internationally at 19 years of age. Her music is beyond Africa. Her music still gets sampled to this day. In fact, you may hear a Brenda sample on Azalea Banks' Paradiso on her Fantasy EP.
You can sun if you want to, fun if you want to, stay in the shade all day if you can to, villa with the shore view, puzzle I adore you, bitches fuck whatever she say they can afford to.
I don't think this current generation will ever grasp how big of a star Brenda was in the continent. Like when fans in Mozambique waited for her arrival at the airport and there were so many fans that she had to be escorted by the military. There really is no one in this continent that compares. But most importantly, we appreciate Fassie's love for black people, our liberation and humanity. Her living amongst us and usage of music in conveying our plight solidified her as a trusted and loyal member of the black family. Fassie's catalogue is a beautiful minefield that reflects the many faces and moments of South African history. When you think of Brenda Fassie, you think of Africa's biggest pop phenomenon. You think of the queen of Afro pop. The legend of all legends, often imitated but could never and will never ever be duplicated. Rest in heavenly peace, Mapr.
One day, I was sitting in my room, in my house, in Orlando, downstairs, and we had an upper floor, and I just had somebody saying, "I am a princess," running up the steps. "I am a princess." Then I asked, "Now, who is that?" They say, "No, that's Brenda Fassie." I say, "No, she's right, she's a princess."